Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Theater for the New City's Dream Up Festival. Please turn off all cell phones. If it beeps or makes noise, please turn it off or mute it. There is no photography or video unless requested by Theater for the New City. Men and women's bathrooms are on the lower level at the foot of the lobby stairs, and there are two exits, one the way you came in, and the second is backstage. We wish you a healthy and prosperous year. May all your dreams come true. We hope this performance will enlighten and delight you and give you a good kickoff to a great theater season ahead. Now, on with the show.
Mexicans didn't deserve Texas anyway.
So, what, do you want it to be the brown paper bag test?
I can't tell the difference. They all look the same to me.
There's a bunch of trees out there. We can get a rope, they understand that.
I always just think of you as white.
Let's order some chain food tonight.
Honey. We're not giving you anything black for Christmas.
You goddamn coon, you didn't leave a tip.
America, founded on the precepts of life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness, and the ownership of slaves for all.
America, a country whose racial segregation is woven into our flag.
America, in a culture defined by division, how can we learn to live together?
Blood on the knees. blood at the roots. Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze.
It is a peculiar sensation, this double consciousness, this sense of always seeing oneself through the eyes of others, of measuring one's soul by the tape of a world that looks on in amused contempt and pity. Why ever feels his two-ness? An American, a Negro, two souls, two thoughts, two unreconciled strivings, two warring ideals in one dark body whose dogged strength alone keeps it from being torn asunder.
Closed flap.
Pleasant little man.
Don't you know who it was?
No, I never saw him before. You know, it's probably just some fresh townie who thinks Jack's indebted to him because he recovered a stolen baseball bat or something, and now he wants to put the acid on him for a dollar or two. You know, Jack is a good-natured slob.
Oh, listen to who is talking.
Jack has always been so good-hearted.
Yeah. He's only stingy with base hits. Oh, it's a great game he pitched today. You know, star players usually fall down when they're captains of teams and it's their last year in college, but not old Jack. Only 3 hits off of him.
This game we saw today, it decides the championship.
Does it not? Certainly, Mother. You don't think I would have screamed my whole voice away if it wasn't, do you? I can hardly speak.
I had to notice this.
Mother, how kind.
I'm not much of a fan, is that what you call it? I don't understand the game, and I'm afraid if it wasn't for Jack playing, I'd find the whole thing rather wearisome.
Jack is the big man of the college tonight, all right? I mean, the president is a mere non-entity beside him. Add to to our list of athletic heroes one Jack Townsend, captain and pitcher.
Oh, help
me. Carry him on the field after the game.
And cheer him.
Oh, you bet we did. And I had a hold of one of his legs. But I agree with you, Mrs. Townsend. If Jack didn't play, I wouldn't take much interest in baseball myself. Now, football, that's a real game.
Now, I don't understand.
Of course, you didn't say that.
It's so gross!
I've heard so many players get injured. When John went away to college, his father and I made him promise not to go out for it on any account.
Well, you spoiled a fine player. Speaking of the angel.
Hail to the hero!
Where's your father?
Right outside, talking to Professor Simmons. After dinner, as we were following out of the inn, we ran into the prof and he walked down with us. Well, did you think we were lost?
We thought you may have forestalled the forthcoming happy event by eloping.
With father for chaperone?
Well, don't you dare do it! I would never forgive you for spoiling my chance to wear my gown. I'm going to be just the most stunning bridesmaid. Am I not, Mother?
Of course you are. Why didn't you invite the professor in?
I did, Mother, but he's on his way somewhere or other.
By the way, Jack, there was a townie in here asking to see you a few minutes ago.
A townie? Did he give any name?
No, he's just some fresh little shrimp, but he said he'd wait, wasn't he outside?
I didn't see anyone.
Well, he'll probably be back, all right? Look out for a touch.
I hear them singing on campus. I'm going out. Hey, Bull, when does the big parade start?
Any minute. I mean, you can hear the clans gathering now.
I'm going to march beside them all the way to the lake.
The lake?
Certainly, Mother. There's going to be canoe carnivals and bonfires and dancing and everything. You simply got to come in honor of Hero Jack.
Come, sis. Praise from you is rare indeed. Indeed.
Indeed.
I'm going to come with you. I'll show you. I can celebrate with the best of you.
Oh. Are you sure it won't be too much for you, Mother?
Nonsense,
Jack. Oh, dear old Mother. Young mother, I should say.
Come on, everybody.
You people go on ahead. I'll catch up with you.
Come on. Jumbo.
Oh, Jumbo and Bull. Lucy thinks I'm a menagerie.
Struck me as symbolical of the way you would always play. strengthening those around you, refusing to weaken at critical moments, advancing others by sacrifices, fighting the good fight for the cause, the team, and always, whether vanquished or victor, reserving a hearty, honest cheer for the other side. Oh, Jack, dear, I love you.
I won't listen any longer. I positively refuse.
It's all over, I'm through. Simply had to tell you.
I shall try, with all my strength, in the future, Evelyn, to live as you have said, and become worthy. Today was nothing. One does one's best for the sake of the game, the love of the struggle. Our best just happened to be luckier, more skillful perhaps than the other fellows, that's all.
So like you to say that. Oh, you're a dear.
Caught the act, Evelyn.
They're waiting outside for you, and Lucy threatens to come in and drag you out. My persuasive powers have no effect. They want to make a start with the steps, see the brave form. Do the start shortly.
I wouldn't miss it for the world. Aren't you coming with us, both of you?
We'll join you. Better still, the parade passes right by here, doesn't it? It always used to in the old days.
Yes, Dad.
Hey, go on ahead, Evelyn, and join the others. And since Lucy tells me she's going to follow the parade, when you pass right by, we'll join you. I've seen and taken part in so many of these affairs that the novelty is sort of worn off for me. And, Jack, if they were to find the hero of the day at this stage of the game, he wouldn't have a rag to his back, eh, Jack?
I'm black and blue all over from their fond caresses this afternoon.
I'll be going, then. You'll surely join us when we pass.
Sure thing.
Bye-bye.
It certainly removes the burden of the years from my shoulders to come back to the old college in the spring, live the old days over in memory, and hobnob with some of the old timers who are young timers with me. It becomes more and more difficult every year, I find. All the old landmarks are disappearing one by one.
Yes, even in my time there have been great changes.
Gives me a painful heart throb every time I come and look for some old place only to find it renovated or torn down.
I can well understand that.
You don't realize what this college comes to mean to you in later years. How it becomes inseparably woven into the fabric of one's lost youth until the two become identical.
Yes, I suppose so.
Happiest days of my life.
Look, of anyone's. Come to the point, Dad.
What? A?
You didn't send Evelyn away in order that you may wax reminiscent. You know that, Dad.
You're right. I did not. But what I ought to speak of is such a deuced painful subject for the both of us that I hardly dare speak it. Especially on your day of triumph, when I should be the last one to bring up any unpleasantness.
Never mind.
You see, I didn't know I'd have no time of getting you alone without rousing your mother's suspicions.
I understand.
And this thing has caused me so much worry. I simply had to hear it from your own lips that everything was all right.
Well, then let me put your mind at rest immediately. Everything is all right.
Thank God for that. Why haven't you written to me?
Until a few days ago, I had nothing new to tell you.
When was the
Operation performed?
Last Monday.
And you've heard from her since?
I received a short note from her that night. It was all over and everything was all right. She said she told me I needn't worry any longer.
Well, that was 5 days ago. You haven't heard any word since?
No.
Well, that's a favorable sign. If any further complications had arisen, she would have surely have let you know, wouldn't she?
Yes, I would think so. I imagine she's frightened to death and doesn't want anything to do with me. I'm sure I hope so. And then you see, I never answered her letter or telephone.
You were wrong there.
I know it, Dad, but I have just received a letter from Evelyn telling me that she was coming out for commencement week and a game, and when I thought of her, the other affair just seemed so horrible and loathsome. I swore I would never speak or write again. When I was certain that she was in no danger, I judged it best for both of us to break off once and for all.
Listen, my boy, are you sure? I mean, one's vanity tends to blind one in such cases. Are you sure, absolutely sure, that you were the father of this child that would have been born to her?
Yes, I am certain of it, as certain as one can possibly be. Oh, I wish to God I had ground for some suspicion of the sort. What a salve it would be for my conscience. To think so would be an insult to a sweet girl. She is a sweet and lovely girl, in spite of everything. And if I had loved her in the least particle, if I had not been in love with Evelyn, I should certainly have married her.
Well, if you did not love this woman, then why did you? I mean, why in the first place?
Why? Why? Who knows why? And who that does know has enough courage to admit even to himself? Be frank, Dad. Judging from several anecdotes that your friend, Professor Simmons, has let slip about your 4 years here, you were no St. Anthony. Turn your mind back to those days and answer your own question. Why are you in the first place?
We've retained a large portion of the original mud in our makeup. That is the only answer I can offer.
Present?
I mean, do you suppose that it's the same man who loves Evelyn who did this other thing? No, 1,000 times no. It was the male beast who ran shivering through the forest after his female thousands of years ago.
Oh, come, Jack. That is pure evasion. You are responsible for the Mr. Hyde in you as well as the Dr. Jekyll. Restraint.
Restraint. Yes. Everybody preaches. But who practices it? And could they if they wanted to? Some impulses are stronger than we are, and have proven themselves so throughout the world's history. Is it not rather our ideals of conduct, of right and wrong, our ethics, which are unnatural and monstrously distorted? Is society not suffering from a case of the evil eye, which sees evil where there is none? Isn't it our moral laws which force me into evasions like the one which you have just found fault with?
You delve too deep, my boy. You can save your radical arguments for the younger generation. I cannot see them in the same light as you do, and if I could, I wouldn't. Now, what I cannot understand is how you happen to get in with this young woman in the first place. You'll pardon me, Jack, but it shows a lack of good judgment on your part and, good taste.
Well, such things usually are errors in taste.
This young woman was hardly of the class that you have been accustomed to associate with, I presume.
She is a working girl, a stenographer.
Does she have any immediate relations who might discover the unfortunate termination of your love affair?
Her father's dead. Her mother is a silly woman who would be the least suspected anything. She has 2 sisters, both youngsters under 10. And a brother, about 18, a machinist of some sort, but he's only home on the weekends.
And she and the brother support the others?
Yes, I know it, Dad. I have played the scoundrel all the way through. I realize that now. Why couldn't you have felt this way before at the start? Then this would have never happened. But at that time, the whole thing just seemed like a pleasant game we were playing. Its serious aspects appeared remote, unreal. I never gave them a thought. I have paid for it since then, and I want you to believe that. I've had my glance into the abyss in loss of confidence and self-respect and bitter self-abasement. I have paid, and I am sure that the result of it all will make me a better man, a man more worthy to be Evelyn's husband.
Well, God rest. I want to thank you for the vote of confidence you gave your father in making a frank appeal to me when you got in this trouble. Shows that you regard me as a friend as well as a father, and that's how I would have it.
Well, you've always urged me to come to you and be frank about everything, and I always have, and always will. Plus, I had to have the money, and I thought I owed it to you to be open and above board and not start deceiving you at such a late day. Could find it in any other way very well. $200 is quite some for a college student to raise at a moment's notice.
The wages of sin are
rather exorbitant. He was the only doctor I could find who would do that sort of thing. He knew I was a college student and probably made some inquiries about your financial rating, and there you are. The only thing I could do was rent and pay, but as I said in my letter, this money is just a loan. It would be unfair for me to make you shoulder mine. Mistakes.
Well, let's forget all about it. All's well that ends well. You have learned your lessons. Now, should we join the others?
A cheer wakens the fever in me. I wanna follow the band and get singed by the Roman candles.
Yes, let's do that.
Meaningful interaction with black people. affluent blacks who understand the passing phenomenon and may try to out you are particularly dangerous.
And blood at the roots. Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees. Pastoral scene. All of the gallant South. Them big bulging eyes and the twisted mouth. Scent of magnolia.
Favorable inside. If any complications had cropped up, she should have been told you by now, wouldn't she?
Yes, I think she would. I imagine she's frightened to death and doesn't want any more to do with me. I'm sure, I hope so. And then you see, I never answered her letter or telephone.
You were wrong, Dad.
I know that, but I just received a letter from Evelyn telling me she's coming off the commencement week in the game. And when I thought of her, the other Ferris seemed so horrible and loathsome, I swore I'd never speak her right again. When I was certain she was in no danger, I judged it best for both of us to break off once and for all.
Listen. My boy, are you sure? Absolutely sure. One's vanity tends to blind one in such cases. Are you sure that you are not the father of this child, which would have been born to her?
Yes, I am certain of it. As certain as one could possibly be. Mr. God, I ground for some suspicion of the sort. What a sob would be for my conscience, but no. Do you even think such is an insult to a sweet girl? For she is a lovely, sweet girl in spite of everything. And if I had loved her at least part of her, if I had not been in love with Evelyn, I should certainly have married her.
If you didn't love this girl, why did you? Why? Why in the first place?
Why? Why? Who knows why? Or who that does know has the courage to confess it, even to himself? To be frank, Eddie. Judging from several anecdotes which your friend Professor Simmons has listed about your 4 years here, you were no saint. Turn your mind back to those days, and then answer your own question. Why in the first place?
We've retained a large portion of the original blood in our makeup. That's the only answer I can think of.
That's it? Do you suppose it was the same man who loves Evelyn who did this other thing? No. 1,000 times no. Just an idea is a war. It was the male beast that ran jibbering through the forest after its female thousands of years ago.
Come, Jack, that is pure evasion. You are responsible for the Mr. Hyde in you as well as the Dr. Jekyll restraint.
Restraint? Ah, yes, everybody preaches good and practices it. And could they if they wanted to? Some impulses are stronger than we are, have proved themselves so throughout the world's history. Is it not rather our ideals of right and wrong, our ethics which are all natural and monstrously distorted? Is not society suffering from the case of the evil eye which sees evil where there is none? Isn't our moral laws which force me into evasions like the one which you have just found fault with?
You are delving too deep for me, my boy. Save your radical arguments for the younger generation. I don't understand them, and if I could, I would. What I cannot understand is how you allowed yourself to get involved with this young woman in the first place. You'll pardon me, Jack, but it seems to me to show a lack of judgment on your part as well as a good taste.
Such things usually are errors of taste.
This young woman is not of the class you're used to, accustomed to associate with, I presume.
She is a working girl, a stenographer.
Does she have any immediate relations who would discover the unfortunate termination of your love affair?
Her father is dead. Her mother is a silly woman who will be the last to suspect anything. She has 2 sisters, both youngsters under 10, and a brother about 18 or something, a machinist or something of the sort. He's only home for weekends.
She and her brother take care of the rest.
So I believe.
I know, Dad.
I played the scoundrel the whole time through. I realize that now. Why couldn't I have looked this way before the start? Then this would never have happened. But at the time, the whole thing seemed just a pleasant game we were playing. Its serious aspects of fear were both unreal. I never gave them a thought. I have paid for it since then. I want you to believe that. I've had my commencement to the abyss. And loss of confidence, and self-respect, and bitter self-abasement I have paid. And I'm sure the result of it all will be to make me a better man. A man more worthy to be Evelyn's husband.
God granted, my boy. I want to thank you for the confidence you placed in me as your father when you got into this trouble. It shows that you not only regard me as a father, but as a friend as well. And that's the way I would have it.
Before I searched me to come to you and be frank about everything, and I always have. I always will. I had to have the money. I thought it best to get above board and not start deceiving you this late day. I couldn't get it any other way very well. And $200 is quite a large sum for a college student to raise a moment's notice.
The wages are sin, our brother, exorbitant.
He was the only doctor I could find who would do that sort of thing. He knew I was a college student and probably made inquiries about your financial rating, and there you are. There's nothing for me to do but grin and pain. But as I said in my letters, this money is a loan. It's be unfair for me to make you short of my mistakes.
Ah, forget about it. You learned your lesson. All's well that ends well. Right. Now, I want to hear the band, that old band puts up the fever in me. I want to get singed by the Roman candles.
Yes, let's do that.
Yes.
Yes, and you murdered her!
I? What? I murdered? Are you crazy?
You and your dirty skunk of a doctor.
Oh.
You thought you were safe, didn't you?
away from home. You go out and pick the championship game, and she lying dead. You could ruin her and throw her down, and no one would say a word because you're a swell college guy and captain of the team. And she ain't good enough for you to marry. She's gonna have a kid. Your kid. But because you're too rotten to act like a man, you send us a figure of a doctor to be killed. And she does what you tell her because she loves you. And you don't even think enough of her to answer her letter when she's dying on account of you.
She told you all.
Not a word. She died game. She wasn't no coward. I tried everything I knew how to get her to tell me, but she wouldn't. Not a word out of her against you. And you. And you, you damn coward, playing ball.
I did what I thought was
better. You sneaked out because you thought she wasn't good enough. You think you can get away with that stuff? And then marry some girl of your own kind, I suppose? Some girl like I see you coming with tonight? But you won't. Not if I have to go to hell for it. I've always hated you since you first come to the house. I've always hated all your kind. You come here to school, and you think you can do as you please with us town people? You treat us like servants. And what are you, I'd like to know? A lot of lazy, no-good dudes sponging off their old men, and the girls, our girls, think you're praying.
You treat us like servants. And what are you, I'd like to know? A lot of lazy, no good dudes sponge on your old men. And the girls, our girls, think they're grand. I knew something would happen. When the old lady sent for me, and I come home and saw Nellie, and she wouldn't leave me go for a doctor, I had a hunch what was wrong. She wouldn't say nothing, but I got our doc, not the one you sent her to. And he told me just what I thought, and said she was going to die. If I'd seen you that minute, I'd have killed you. I knew it was you, but I couldn't prove it. Then one of the kids got scared and told me, Nellie sent it to your doc for medicine when she first took sick. I bought a gun and the kid showed me where it was. I shoved the gun in his face and he owned up and told me about you. He offered me money. Lots of it, to keep my mouth shut, and I took it. The money he got from you, blood money. When I keep my mouth shut, maybe.
Look, Murray, this affair is unspeakably horrible, and I am everything that you say I am. You must believe me that I honestly thought I was acting for the best in having the operation performed. That it turned out so terrible is awful. I feel as if I were what you called me, a murderer. You cannot realize how I'm suffering. It's horrible. Horrible. The thought of it will torture me all my life.
That will bring me back to life. You're too late.
Too late? I mean, what do you mean? You haven't told anyone.
When I left this office, I went home and she was dead. Then I come up here looking for you. I wanted to kill you. But I've been thinking, you're not worth getting hung for. I can see a better way of fixing you. Willing to get you right.
You haven't told anyone.
What's the difference? It's plenty of time. I know.
see a better way of fixing you. One that'll get you right.
You haven't told anyone.
What's the difference? There's time. I know.
Murray, for your own sake, for your dead sister's good name, for your family's sake, you must keep this thing quiet. I gotta prove myself. I'm willing to have you punish me individually in any way you see fit. But there are others, innocent ones, who will suffer.
She was innocent too before you stopped.
My mother and father, my sister, this would kill my mother if she knew. They are innocent. Do not revenge yourself on them.
You killed my sister.
Why do you keep saying that? You know it was an accident. That I would gladly have given my own life rather than have it happen, and you must keep silent. I will do anything you want, I tell you. If you say the doctor gave you money, I'll give you 10 times as much as he did. My father is rich, we'll give you a good position. Do everything you wish. Only do not punish the innocent.
You want to pay me for nothing?
So what did you see?
Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees. Blood on the leaves.
I just need to clear my mind now. It's been racing since the summertime.
Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees.